So Prabhuji and Mataji are very senior members of the ISKCON congregation here in Pune. And Krishna Kishore Prabhu, he is a professor of computer engineering and dean industry relations, and also the placement officer at VIT College in Pune. He has corporate and teaching experience of more than 23 years and has received a lot of awards for his excellence in teaching. He's very well known among the students in VIT. He was introduced to ISKCON long ago in 1994, and ever since then he's been a student of Bhagavad Gita and teacher also of the Gita, along with the other knowledge that he teaches. He spreads the message of Gita to people from all walks of life. He's been very actively associated with ISKCON Pune, and he's a counselor in Pune for dozens of families, and helping them also in their journey of Krishna consciousness. Rasundri Mataji is also a science graduate, and she's been a homemaker, focusing on their two wonderful children, who she has been homeschooling since the last 10 years. She's also been a coordinator and a teacher of Bhakta Prahlad School in Pune for more than 10 years. And also their two sons are very, very famous for Pune congregation. With their older son, he used to give Bhagavatam classes when he himself was a small child. So they are very, as I said, very uniquely qualified to talk about the topic today, which is how to raise boys in Krishna consciousness. So again, thank you so much, Prabhuji Mataji, for taking out time and being with us here today. We can get started whenever you all are ready.
Yeah. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Good evening, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be with all of you this Sunday afternoon to talk on this topic of raising boys in Krishna consciousness. So this topic would be having the following parts to it, the outline for today's discussion. Initially, I would like to do a brief recap of the five koshas and also a brief note on the goal of parenting. I understand that this particular group, you had just recently organized a talk on raising girls in Krishna consciousness by Radharani Mataji from ISKCON Mumbai. So I heard that talk. We actually heard that talk just to ensure that we don't repeat the same things. So since she spoke about some concepts beautifully, I would be just only recapping what she already spoke and then going ahead. Okay, so if anyone has not heard that, please do hear it. Because certain principles are certainly common between raising boys and girls, just that there are some dynamics that are going to be different. So since we heard that talk, we would start with that, a brief recap of the five koshas and what Mataji spoke. So that will be the first theme today. Then we wish to take, two themes from Bhagavad Gita related to parenting and discuss that. That is, that's going to be the bulk of today's talk. And then, there are so many practical points that we could speak of, especially in the context of raising boys, but we have chosen around four themes to speak. Okay, so we would be touching all these four practical points. I also have a dozen quotes from Chanakya related to parenting, success of parenting, and so on. So Prabhupada valued Chanakya Pandit's statements a lot. So we would be looking at certain statements from Chanakya and then concluding and taking questions. Okay, so I believe that we have time for total maybe 1.5 hours. So that's what I understand. So maybe we would go till around 5:10, 5:15 or so. Maybe for an hour we would speak, and then we can just see if there are any questions. So that is the outline for today's session. So let's right away begin with a brief recap of the Panchakosha concept. So this was spoken very well by Radharani Mataji, as I mentioned. She actually starts her talk with Chanakya's quote of Lalayet Panchavarshani Dashavarshani Tadayet Praptute Shodashe Varsham Putram Mitra Sacharet. That means first 5 years you give, unconditional love. And then in the age between 6 and 15, we discipline the child. And then from the age of 16, your son or daughter, he or she is a friend to you now. So this she very elaborately spoke. And she also spoke on the five koshas. So I've just put everything in one slide. The five koshas that she touched on in her talk. How the kosha means a sheath, just like a sword is there in a sheath. Similarly, our consciousness, our chitta is covered by these five layers called annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, and anandamaya. So annamaya refers to the body, pranamaya the energy, manomaya the mind, vijnanamaya the intellect, and anandamaya the bliss. Okay, so in the age between 0 to 5, mainly it is the annamaya that is developing. So the focus on good food, right kind of input to the senses in that age and so on is annamaya. But of course, annamaya continues even later, but 0 to 5 is especially important. Pranamaya is energy, 6 to 10. Like we see children between 6 to 10, they're always jumping. They want to, you know, jump around. They are very quick. If you have 2 children at home, one is 7-year-old and another is 12-year, and you tell both of them to do some task, the 7-year-old really starts running. He wants to do it, right? So there is a lot of energy. So that has to be cultivated in that age. If it is done well, so the whole idea is that if in the right age, the right thing is done, later the individual benefits a lot in life. That is this whole discussion. Manomaya is the mind. So the age between 11 to 15, you know, we have seen how things like music in that particular age actually helps. Developing relationships with friends, with family members, etc. All that would aid in the development of Manomaya Kosha between 11 to 15. Vijnanamaya or intellect starts opening up from 16 onwards. You know, the typical time people start going to colleges and they ask questions, who am I and so on, is the age for Vijnanamaya Kosha, the intellect development. And finally, bliss or Anandamaya is there throughout. But even Radharani Mataji mentions this point that, you know, once the child is 21 or 25, he or she at that time is a fully grown, mature adult and now could take a decision in terms of how he or she wants to worship Krishna. Okay, so that can happen very well if the previous koshas are well done. Okay, so Mataji did speak a lot on all this, so I'm not going to speak more on this. Only I would like to say that how in our Indian Hindu scriptures especially, you see these five devatas who are there. Shakti, she is the embodiment of Annamaya Kosha. Surya is Pranamaya. Ganapati is Manomaya. Lord Shiva is Vijnanamaya Kosha. And Vishnu, Krishna, is the Adipati or in charge of Anandamaya Kosha. He is the worshipable object of that. Okay, so as devotees of Krishna, we are all certainly interested in you know, our relationship with Krishna. But that can be very smooth if the previous koshas are intact so that the individual is very stable and mature. Okay. And what you see on the right side on the slide is also how stones have only annamaya. So, you know, some stones grow actually. They're called as living stones. Whereas if you see plants have annamaya and pranamaya. So there are plants which are like touch me not or, you know, which get influenced by energy, prana. Animals have manomaya kosha also. That's why you can relate to a dog or a cat or a cow. We see that they have a mind. You can actually have a relationship with them, at least at some level. But it is only the human being in which the anandamaya, the vijnana and anandamaya kosha opens up. Okay, so the goal of this discussion was how to ensure the right kosha is done at the right time so that the individual is stable, strong within, mature as he or she goes up. Right, so I'll not touch more on this. This was covered earlier. So please hear that to get more on this. Okay, the next theme that we wish to speak on is, you know, some important goals of parenting while raising children. Now, this again applies to boys and girls both, but we are talking here more from boys' perspective. Yeah.
Yeah, so as he said, these 4 goals apply for both boys and girls. It's very important for everybody actually, so that one can develop very nicely. They are how to be dharmic. Now, dharmic doesn't mean whether one is a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian. We are not talking about that dharma over here. We are talking about dharma that is in every field of activity that we do, like how to deal with elders, how to deal with one's teachers, parents, equals, how to deal with the opposite sex, to what extent there can, you know, like we, there is so much of this free mixing culture nowadays. So how much it should be restricted and how much they can, how they should deal with each other. That also comes under the category of dharma. Everything that we do daily, including what we eat, when we eat, how we eat, even that comes under this aspect of dharma. So children should learn all these things from their very childhood. They should know that, okay, this is the time for a particular activity and this is not the time for eating, or this is not something that I'm supposed to eat, or this is not how I'm supposed to eat. So children should learn these things. Like, for example, we are hearing so many of Ayurvedic seminars and everything, and they tell us Ayurveda is all about lifestyle, prevention. So we learn how to lead a healthy lifestyle so that we don't spoil our health. So these things should be taught to children so that they grow with that kind of an understanding and science behind everything. They should know what they are eating, what they are drinking, how much to indulge in all this. So that is also coming under dharma. And also as they grow up, they should be very aware of how to earn money. What is dharmic way of, dharmic ways of earning money? How one should not earn money? And what kind of dress to wear, and you name it, everything that we do in our daily life. Everything comes under this aspect of dharma, and basically which means sadgun and sadachar, how to behave, what kind of qualities to develop. So these things, children should grow up learning these things so that it becomes a part of their life. It is very easy when something becomes routine for us, when something becomes very part of our life. We become consciously competent in following some things, then it is very easy to apply these things even when one grows up. Then the next point is about Balavan. For both boys and girls, it is very important to have very good physical fitness right from young age. So they should be given facilities to do good exercises, physical activities, play sports, or, you know, do yoga at home, and so many things. If they are boys, like today we are focusing more on boys, then there are so many activities, because boys have so much energy in them, and they, that energy has to come out and it should be utilized in the right way. So they should have a lot of physical activity, and that's very good for their development physically also, and it keeps them very engaged. So we have to find out, and we have to facilitate these kind of opportunities to them. Otherwise, if they remain idle, they are only going to take shelter of the screen. They will start playing some kind of PUBG and games like that, which is very harmful for the body also and the mind also. So it is very important that we engage them in physical activities compulsorily every day. And then comes kushalta. Kushalta means to be very skillful with one's hands. So this also children can start doing from right from their childhood. They should be taught, they should be empowered to do many things. It is not, many times parents feel that, oh, my child is very small, how can he or she do this? They have to grow up. But actually we can never underestimate them. As a small child, one can do many, many things. One can do many more things than elders. A lot, many things they can do at a very young age. Like Prabhupada used to say that in India, even a 5-6-year-old girl knows how to make a dough for chapati. And by 5th standard and all, girls would start cooking in those days. And now also many girls are very interested. But this should not be very limited for girls. Even boys should learn. They can learn all these skills, like lifestyle management. Many times after 12th standard, boys have to go here and there and stay out somewhere outstation. Even if they stay in their own parents' home, but sometimes parents may go out for some work. They may go out of town and the child has to stay at home for 2-3 days alone. So in that situation, the boy should not become helpless and start depending on neighbors or buy bread and eat. So that child should at least learn to make some basic things. He can at least make some dal, rice, khichdi, chapati, some sabjis. how to boil milk and how to offer these things and manage his own lifestyle for a few days. So this kind of training should start from the childhood. And believe me, a child who is in third, fourth standard can also start assisting in cooking. Initially, they can help with sorting out vegetables and doing simple things. And as they grow up a little bit, we can give them a knife with very cautiously telling them how to do it, how to use it. They can do many other things like that. And we have even seen in Mayapur how the Gurukulis, they can make a big feast for almost 1,000 people, all the 100 people, sorry, I gave a wrong number, 100 people. We heard that they can make a big feast for 100 people and they are all small boys. So this is all coming under Kushalta. That means you are able to do something with your hands. And this is not only cooking, but there are so many things that they can do. It can be some kind of it could be artwork, or you can figure out what all they can do. So to do some skill with hand, that is very important. And the fourth one is to be a Vidwan. So when all the first three things are there in place, it is very easy to be a Vidwan. Otherwise, it will be very superficial knowledge. Vidwan means to be knowledgeable. But if one has not gone through, one has not learned how to be dharmic, one doesn't have physical strength, one is not skillful with hands, then his vidvatta is very superficial. So from childhood itself, we can train boys how to be dharmic, how to be balavan, take care of your body, eat properly, sleep in time, how to be kushal with your hands, and then how to acquire knowledge.
Yeah, so basically now we come to the heart of the seminar, which is about, the theme from Bhagavad Gita that I wish to speak on. So in the Bhagavad Gita first chapter as well as the 13th chapter, especially the first chapter, this concept comes up. You know, we all know the first verse of the first chapter is called Dharma Kshetre Kuru Kshetre, right? So there are these two words, Dharma and Kshetra. And this is, something that I wish to touch on. So Dharma Kshetra. So we wish to touch on this fact that parenting or raising a boy is something like creating a Dharma Kshetra. That means we all know what is a Kshetra is like. Kshetra means a place. Okay. So just like a vessel you see here, childhood is a time when you build that character. And that character should be a character of Dharma Kshetra. It should be a place where Dharma is properly fixed in. And if that is there, if the pot is designed like that, then taking to Krishna consciousness, becomes very easy, in one's later age, when a person has grown up. Right. So we'll be touching on that. So the first thing that I wish to start speaking about is, what is Dharma? So Dharma is a very big word. She already spoke something about it when she spoke about Dharmavan, as the first goal in raising a child. But so for example, there are two words in Sanskrit. There is Dharma and there is Shraddha. Shraddha means faith. So just like, we talk about faith in Krishna, we speak about So Shraddha is more related to a particular deity to whom we show our affection. That is actually Shraddha. But Dharma is kind of considered more primary, the base on which Shraddha comes up. Okay, so between Dharma and Shraddha, we need to remember that Dharma is considered more fundamental. And Shraddha sits on top of Dharma. So for example, if you have seen the fourth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, there is the story of Dharma, who gets married to 13 daughters of Daksha. So Dharma marries Shraddha, Dharma marries Medha, and so on. So there is that whole description. It's a beautiful section of the Srimad Bhagavatam. What it indicates is that when Dharma comes along with some other quality, then it becomes beautiful. But without that proper Dharma, the Shraddha remains too superficial. And there is always a chance that it can become like a hippie culture, basically. So Shraddha without Dharma is like, kind of it can be like a hippie or a person who is you know, very unstable in his practices. So that's what actually happens. Okay, so going into something more concrete, how to ensure that we give dharma? So what is the dharma that we're talking about? In the Bhagavad Gita first chapter, if you read, there are two words that come in between 1.39 and 1.43. You will read two terms called as Kula Dharma and Jati Dharma. Okay, so Prabhupada translates Kula Dharma as family traditions and Jati Dharma as community projects. Okay, so this is the translation given by Prabhupada in the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, if you open up, between 1.39 and 1.43. So let's talk something about this. What we want to say here is, based on the family that we are in, we have certain family traditions or Kula Dharma, or the way in which we worship the Lord, the way we observe festivals, the way we do certain types of rituals at home, etc. These things are considered Kula Dharma, and we should never underestimate the importance of that. Even as devotees, we should never think that, oh, perhaps this is not necessary and so on. These kind of family dharma or family traditions are like a bridge, actually, which has ensured that in India, even today, generation after generation, people are pious. Okay, so for example, why did Prabhupada say always that Indians are very close to Krishna? It is because of the Kula Dharma. It is because of the family traditions that has been coming. So even as devotees of Krishna, we should not underestimate the importance of that or neglect that in the raising of our children. Okay, so to give some concrete examples. So first of all, you know, whatever festivals we observe. So let's say even Janmashtami. I'm sure that each of us, depending on which place in India we come from, it may be Gujarati or we may be South Indian or whatever, we have certain ways in which our family would celebrate Janmashtami, right? We all know that. So even after coming to ISKCON and connecting to Srila Prabhupada, we should ensure that at home we do such celebrations. Okay, so we should celebrate festivals at home the way our families have celebrated it. Okay, and even there are several other festivals which perhaps may not be celebrated in the temple, but which may be very important. I'll give a simple example. Let's say the festival of Navratri. So now, if you see in India, from top to down, everywhere in India, there is a Navratri festival. There is a way in which it is celebrated. Like in South India, we keep a Golu. We have a particular way in which we celebrate Navratri. So I'm sure in every part, so I understand that many devotees here are from Surat. So in Gujarat, if you see, Navratri is not just about that wild dandiya dance that happens with cinema music. So that's a perverted way of celebrating it. There is actually a very wonderful way, an authentic way in which such festivals are celebrated. Right. So these celebrations should be taught to our children. That is actually Kula Dharma. That is the family tradition of a particular celebration. Similarly, even other rituals. So for example, in some family, maybe there is a tradition of doing some yajna like Agnihotra. Or in some families, you know, they have the sacred thread ceremony where the boy does some sandhya in the morning and evening. He does some argya to the sun. In some families, they have some fasting for some girls in particular time of the year. So what I'm trying to say is that there are several rituals in each of our families. And sometimes what even may have happened is we may have lost touch with them. It's even likely that even our parents have lost touch with them. You know, so sometimes it's also good to have some elderly people in family, like our grandparents, etc., who can tell us what was our family tradition of doing something. So let's remember, a devotee of Krishna is Saragrahi. Saragrahi means we always take the essence from everywhere. Okay, so since we take the essence from everywhere, we should conscientiously ensure that we take the essence of our own family traditions and give that to our children, because these are the bridges. These are the bridges which, you know, are always going to be there, right? And then Shraddha or faith is on top of that. And without that bridge, that Shraddha can become very superficial, it can become sentimental, it can become hippie style worship also. Okay, so this is the importance of Kula Dharma. And please remember, Arjuna was very worried in the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita that because of the war, Kula Dharma will be destroyed, right? So we all know that. And that fear was correct, actually. It was indeed true. Right. So this is an important point to maintain this. So similarly, there are so many other things, like even Shraddha ceremonies. Like, I'm sure that in every family in India, there is a particular way in which the ancestors are treated. Our children should see that from childhood. How do we treat our parents when they are living? And when they are gone, how do we respect them by having Shraddha ceremonies? Correct. So every place in India, these things are observed according to our own traditions. And this needs to be maintained. This is called Kula Dharma. Jati Dharma, Prabhupada translates as community project. It means talent. That means in every family, depending on the family we belong to, there is a particular talent that is available in the family. Let's say somebody's business family. So there is a particular talent of, the way you do business. There is the talent of, running a business. So as children grow up, they should be involved in that. So even a 12-year-old boy or a girl should be involved in that community project, the Jati Dharma. Okay, so let's say, there are so many families in India with, every family actually, has some Jati Dharma, right? That means traditionally what their families did to earn money or to, what was their talent actually. So these talents need to be preserved and passed on generation after generation. Somebody is coming from a Brahmana family, maybe they know how to recite some sections of the Vedas, the Upanishads, a scholarly ability. Maybe some family is there which is very good with Sanskrit, even with our own mother tongue. So all these things must be given. So this is all dharma, actually. This is what Arjuna refers to in the Bhagavad Gita first chapter as Kula Dharma and Jati Dharma, right? And we know that Arjuna was afraid that in the war, because so many men will die, Kula Dharma, Jati Dharma will be destroyed, because no one will be there who can give Kula Dharma, Jati Dharma to their sons. And that was Arjuna's fear. And mind you, that fear was a bona fide fear. It was correct fear that he was having, actually. And historically, it is said that it indeed happened like that. There was a lot of social disruption after the war. Right. So we are talking about this as fundamental, which is to be given to our children. Right. So moving ahead, so container and content. So let's remember that Dharma Kshetra is basically the container, and the content is Shraddha. So if you see on the right side, I have a bucket with all holes in it. So if the Dharma is not there properly in the character of an individual, even if you put Shraddha inside, it will leak out from all the holes, right? Because the Dharma Kshetra is not formed properly. Hence, the character of the child when he or she grows up will be such that there will be so many leakages, and whatever Shraddha is put inside will keep leaking and going out, and the person will be very unstable. Okay, so let's never minimize the rituals, the various worships that our families had. And unfortunately, in today's age, increasingly it has got disrupted in India, where due to urbanization or even due to modern culture, where people have not given importance to their own family cultures, people have actually destroyed these bridges. And this is very dangerous, because this has the potential to make the next generation of children in India just like American children, basic hippie kind of stuff. And then they are very unstable in their lives later. They are unstable in their relationships. They are unstable in their personal, mental health, everything. Right. So this is the importance of dharma. And please try to understand that this can be done only in childhood. There are some things that have to be done at the right time. Okay. So for example, if your child has not seen, the parents doing certain festivals, certain rituals in a particular way, he or she is never going to do it in their life. It will never happen, because this is basic dharma. This is given only between 5 and 15. So thus formative years are extremely important, where they have an exposure to the Kula Dharma and Jati Dharma of the family, right? And many times when I meet several devotees, etc., I get this feeling that sometimes devotees feel that, oh, there is nothing good in my family and so on. But I truly believe it is not like that. For that, even the parents would have to do some effort to study about their own family, Kula Dharma, Jati Dharma, through their elders, etc., because sometimes even we may have lost touch with that. So these are important points here, right? So the samskriti, samskar, dharma, etc. So simple things like, offering obeisances to all elders in family, right? Treating our parents nicely. These examples we also need to set in front of our children. Only then they will actually get samskar. So please remember, samskar is something that is caught. You know, it's not just taught like a lecture. It has to be assimilated as part of the culture, you know, of the family, right? Otherwise, what goes in is just like a dustbin. It's just getting filled up, right? So this is very important to celebrate all festivals meticulously at home. Even simple things like Raksha Bandhan, you know, there is such an importance in it, the brother and sister coming together, right? So every ritual, every festival at home, we should make it very lively. This is actually a very important part of raising children. Even the food, like I'm sure in every part of India for every festival, we cook certain items, right? Whether it is Gujarat or South India, anywhere. For every festival, there are certain things that are done. As parents, we need to learn that. We need to ensure that we maintain those traditions. Correct. And these samskaras, let's remember, they're universal. So if you see samskaras, how many samskaras are there in childhood? Everything is in childhood only, because the impression is deeply formed in childhood. And once that is done, then later you're only, you know, it's like you can only fill the pot, you know, but the pot is made in childhood, that pot that I showed earlier on. So this is dharma. The next point which I want to take from Bhagavad Gita, the theme is called as kshetra. So this kshetra terms comes not only in Bhagavad Gita first chapter, in the first verse, dharma kshetra, but this also comes in 13th chapter, where Arjuna is asking, explain the difference between kshetra, kshetrajna, and so on. So please try to understand, kshetra means field of activities, correct? So just like a farmer has a field, then that field is called as kshetra. Similarly, for every child, the body and mind of the child is the field, correct? The body and mind of the child is the field. And a very important part of growing up is to understand the character and capacity of that field. Okay, so I'll just elaborate on this with a simple example from Ramayana. If you see in the Ramayana, there is this beautiful story of all the monkeys that arrive at the ocean and they wish to jump to Lanka, correct? And they know that Lanka is some 100 yojanas away from the place where they are sitting. So every monkey starts saying how much he can jump. So one monkey says, I can jump 5 yojanas. Another says, I can jump 10 yojanas. Another says, I can jump 20. Some says 30, 40, 50, 60. You know, one says I can jump 90. One says I can jump 100, but I cannot come back. And then finally, it is Jambavan, we know, who reminds Hanuman that, hey, you can jump 100. And why 100? You can jump even 100,000 and come back comfortably. What you see in that story is every monkey knew his character and capacity. See, every monkey knew his capacity. Every monkey knew, I can jump 5 yojanas. I can jump 10. They knew their capacity. What they're capable of doing, they knew. So please try to understand. So this is a very important point. This is called capacity. Character means, what is my core nature? So for example, all of them knew that they're monkeys and they can jump. So that's character. Capacity means how much they can jump. Limitation means what they cannot do. So for example, one monkey said that I can jump 100 yojanas, but I can't come back. I may not be able to come back. Correct? So kshetra and kshetrajna means the person inside, right? Kshetrajna is actually the atma, and kshetra is the body and mind, okay, and position. So why I'm saying this is, childhood is a time for this essential self-discovery of what the child is capable of. That means, what is the child's field of activities? So actually, most important part of education is this. I mean, going to school, everything is good. But most important part of education, which we need to do with our boys and girls, is this discussion, helping them understand their kshetra, which is the real area of interest. What is it? How much they can do in that? See, otherwise, there's a lot of frustration in life, right? Like, you know, many children, they start studying for some IIT JEE exam in 12th standard, and they understand that it is becoming too difficult for them. And, you know, unfortunately, so many children commit suicide also in India. We see this in exams when they don't get marks, etc. All this is basically happening because this essential discovery has not been done somehow, unfortunately, as to who am I, how much can I achieve in my life? So this thing is something which children, it starts from the age of 6, actually. So ideally, education is such that till the age of 10, 12, it is supposed to be broad, especially 13 to 16. This is a very important time in the life of a boy where दिस डिस्कवरी इज टू बी डन एज टू व्हाट आई एम केपेबल ऑफ, मैं कितना पढ़ाई कर सकता हूँ, कैन आई हैंडल समथिंग, कैन आई हैंडल फॉर एग्जाम्पल ओके आई वॉन्ट टू गो टू आई आई टी, गुड ड्रीम, कैन आई हैंडल स्टडिंग 15 आवर्स फॉर 2 years और 3 years, इज दैट माई कैपेसिटी honestly, I mean, not just because everybody is going to IIT, can I do it? Can I do it happily? Is that my character? What is my limitation? If I cannot do it, then I need to understand what else I can do. So all this discovery is supposed to be done as part of growing up. And as parents, we need to help our children understand this. Okay, so basically, as I have written down also, life is a journey and not a destination. So basically, we need to encourage our children to walk the life in terms of enjoying what they are doing. Even the studies that they are doing, you know, it should never be a burden. I always felt, because we homeschool children, so we always tried to teach those subjects or try to tell them to study subjects in such a way that it interests them. So, because every subject can be studied like that, you know, even the physics, chemistry, mathematics, or even your history, geography, everything can actually be studied in a way, in the true spirit of it, that actually interests you in life, you know, so that you enjoy that journey of studies. So this is again something we need to discuss with our boys as they are growing up, so that they develop the right mood towards it. Otherwise, unfortunately, you know, this whole studies can become very frustrating. It can become, you know, burdensome. Okay, so this is the first theme that we wish to speak on, dharma and kshetra. How it is important for our children, for us to ensure the dharma while raising them up, the kula dharma, jati dharma, you know, and other aspects of dharma that she spoke of in the beginning, and about kshetra, about understanding my own body and mind, what am I capable of, what would I like to do in this world. That discovery also is supposed to happen at least by the age of 16-17, right? So this is a very important part of growing up, which in which parents have to play an active role. Okay, so in dharma we play a much more active role, but in kshetra we aid them, because ultimately it is their kshetra, so they have to make the decision. But you need to be with your boys as they are making that decision, to really help them out, to you know, to discuss with them on these topics, right? So this is the first theme that we wish to speak on. Now the second theme that we wish to speak today is 4 practical points to remember while raising boys. Now, these are more specific with boys. What we spoke earlier, that was relevant perhaps to girls as well, but this is more specific to boys. So first one is brahmacharya, dealing with screen TV. Second, sibling rivalry, hobbies, free time, etiquette at home, and dealings with family. So let's start with one by one. The first one. Okay, so since we are talking about boys specifically, so Srila Prabhupada in one lecture in Melbourne in 1975, he said that if a boy can maintain brahmacharya or celibacy until the age of 25, he said that your brain will become so fertile. And it is said that Prabhupada emphasized on that word so. You know, he elongated it a lot. The idea being that this is a very important practical part of growing up for boys, maintaining celibacy, maintaining brahmacharya. Now, brahmacharya, let us understand, this is not just physical, it is mental first. Okay, mental as in it all comes from dharma, it comes from etiquette. If I have not understood as a boy how to deal with, you know, if I wrongly deal with opposite sex in the mind, etc., then it's very difficult to maintain this, right? So here I wish to speak on dealing with screen and mobile in today's world, you know, very briefly. So one thing I think this pandemic has taught us is that screen is an inevitable part of everyone's life, right? So there was a joke circulating around which said that previously in schools there was a notice board, mobile not allowed. But today what has happened, the school only has come into the mobile, right? Because from nursery, everybody or every child is on mobile only nowadays. So in some sense, I think the pandemic has taught us that in today's world, nobody can say that I will not give mobile to my child at all. In fact, every child is sitting with a mobile only at least in the last 1 year. Okay, so that part is very clear. Yeah, but now what to do in that? So of course, one thing is using the mobile. So for education, that is one thing. But besides that, there are certain things which we should actually be very careful about from their childhood, because this is in connection with brahmacharya also. So there are so many things that they could see on the screen, right? You know, on TV, on mobile, on internet, you know, through everything. So one thing is about, you know, there are so many historic things, environment related, educative, patriotic also. Even there are some, I'm sure that recently there was this Uri, the surgical strike film that came about. It had a patriotic touch to it, value-based stuff. So there are some decent material that comes up time and again on the screen, which is fine, certainly, because there is some educational element in it. So since it's unavoidable, it is fine. So that is fine. Another thing that I feel is fine is, especially as boys grow up at the age of 14, 15, they become generally interested in politics, in what is happening nationally, elections, news, etc. So in a controlled way, looking at these kind of things are also perhaps important for boys in terms of the general knowledge, because, you know, when they go to college, etc., they can't be a fool. They need to understand what is happening. Right. So in a controlled way, these things are also fine. What is not fine, you know, from the next onwards, it is actually, at least I would say personally, it's better to avoid it. Entertainment, sports, you know, this IPL stuff where hours together, children start looking at TV cricket on screen. It is even fine to play cricket for 2 hours because at least it will give you a good health. But as far as possible, we should completely discourage this act of passive watching screen for entertainment in terms of sports, etc. I think it is a habit that once formed is very difficult to come out. And most people, they remain servants of this kind of entertainment industry lifelong. Even all kinds of romantic scenes should be completely avoided. I'm not even talking about adult movies or something. I'm talking about... you know, the normal Bollywood kind of dance and all that stuff. It is not good to maintain brahmacharya. I mean, you cannot, because when a young boy at the age of 13, 14, 12 starts seeing such things on the screen, you know, woman dancing and all that, that is extreme. I mean, woman dancing, I'm not talking about Bharatnatyam or some very classical dance, which is devotional. I'm talking about this Bollywood kind of dance, that music and that dance, that is extremely passionate. And there is absolutely no doubt that maintaining brahmacharya becomes an impossibility. You know, then as Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, if something is going on in the mind, it is just a matter of time before it comes in the body. Otherwise, you're a hypocrite. It cannot happen. Right. So this kind of understanding we should have for what things screen is fine and for what things screen must be completely avoided. So I think, see, Radharani Mataji made this point actually, which I liked very much when she spoke about raising girls. She said that when children are comparatively younger, you know, 8 year, 9 year old, we have much more influence on them. And that time they actually listen to us. So the right kind of habits with all this should be formed much earlier. You know, if a boy is already now 17 year old and he has been watching IPL every year last 4 years, suddenly this year, if you tell him don't watch IPL, he is going to shout back at you because he will say that kya baat kar raha, kyun nahi dekhun abhi? Because after the age of 16, he has become your friend now. So please remember what I'm talking right now. This is especially relevant in the age group 6 to 12. You know, before they have hit teenage, you have some kind of, I don't want to use the word control, but that looks the most appropriate word right now, where you have a certain influence over them, where if you tell something to them, perhaps they will listen. And the right alternatives must be there, mind you. I mean, they should not feel a vacuum of it. It's not that they are feeling, oh, my father is not allowing me to see IPL. I'm missing it so much. Then there is no point. The life should be so busy that there is no time only for that. Right. And that's actually parenting. As parents, our role is to ensure that they have enough things to do in their day, which satisfies them, which tires them out, so that they don't go only to this thing, right? But at the same time, I don't want to say that screen must not be used at all, because as I told you, that is not possible. That is why the first 2 points that I mentioned, learning about history, environment, educative videos, patriotic video, value-based videos, politics, news, these are some things which certainly from the age of at least 13, 14, they should start seeing. Otherwise, you know, there is a problem in their growth as well. But the later 2 things that I have written, things like IPL, entertainment, sports, European soccer, you know, all this stuff, better play football than watch that. Romance, Bollywood, this stuff should be as far as possible till the age of 16, if you can avoid it. We really feel that then later it's the boy's choice, but then it's most likely that they will not see because now their life has become already full. right? So that's what I want to say. So this is the first point, practical point in raising children. Now the second one is about sibling rivalry.
It's inevitable to have two boys at home, and there's going to be a lot of sibling rivalry. You can see the picture over here. This is a very common scene that happens. It's very normal. There's no need to panic about that, because boys do have a lot of energy, and if they are not very engaged when they are free, they get into all this. As parents, we should take care that they don't hurt each other and they don't use bad language. But sometimes they enjoy this like as sports. This is like a sporting activity for them. So every time, even boys don't like if we interfere into this. Sometimes they may even feel that we are not fighting. They both will unite and they'll wonder why we are interfering in their play. So we have to silently observe and see that they are not hurting each other and they are not using any bad language or anything like that. It's not getting very serious. If it's under check, then there is no problem. And this is something natural. And I think it reduces with age as they grow and they mature. So this is one thing. And if something is really bad and we feel that they are fighting a lot and they are responding very badly to situations, then sometimes it is very difficult to tell them at that time. So after things have cooled down, it's a little easier to discuss with them and tell them that how they could have responded in a better way. That's one thing that we have observed. And also in teenage, like when boys reach teenage, then it is important as a mother that mothers are very strict with the boys. They listen to mothers, and we have to be very strict with them in certain aspects and see that they are growing up properly and not doing any mischievous activities. And also when they reach their teenage, it is good to, it is not a time when we give them instructions. They don't like it. So it is good to give suggestions that time and to tell them the pros and cons of doing something, to suggest very gently that, okay, if you do this, this is what is going to happen. And if you do it the other way, then these are going to be the consequences. So you decide. So it is good to suggest and tell them about the consequences of whatever decisions they take and whatever they want to do. Like say they may want to play some kind of a video game because other boys in the locality are playing. So if we directly tell them, no, this is not good for you. This is, devotees don't do this. And they may not like it. But if we tell them the pros and cons, what happens, what are the ill effects of doing these things on the mind and our own life, and discuss like that, then they may understand. So as boys approach teenage, we also have to take a different approach in correcting them and giving them a different, giving them a direction in life. And also in that, there has to be some flexibility for them. They should feel that they have the freedom to choose what they want to do. And yet we give them the wall of dharma, and within the walls of dharma, we give them the freedom to make the right decisions. So that's how we deal with them in their childhood and in their teenage. Childhood, it is very easy. We can just tell them directly. But as they grow up, it is not very easy to directly tell them that, no, don't do this, don't do that. So we have to give them choices, and they have to feel that they have some freedom to choose. So that's important over here, that we learn and grow with them in our dealings.
Yeah, The next thing that we wish to speak on is hobbies and free time. So again, now this is another important aspect of growing up, developing the right kind of hobbies. Hobbies are all, if you see carefully, you know, even the hobbies that all of us have right now, it is based on what we did in our childhood. So this is very important because leisure time is going to be there with everyone in life. And how you deal with your leisure time is important. Okay, so one thing I learned, which I remember very well, which I learned from Aruda Mataji, who conducts seminars on homeschooling children, etc., is about the 5 hours of education. This is connected to hobby, so that's why I'm saying here. She says that writing, reading, raga is music, rote, that means by hearting shlokas, etc., and arithmetic, mathematical, logical ability. These are, she says, the 5 aspects of education. I liked it very much because it's perfect if you think about it. Educating boys is all about ensuring that they are able to write nicely, because writing is a very important skill. Writing basically is about how you put your thoughts into words. It allows you to, you know, think very deeply on any subject. And reading also. And if you see, you know, writing and reading has a lot of importance in our Krishna consciousness also. Because we are all encouraged to read scriptures. We are all encouraged to write based on scriptures or give talks based on scriptures, etc. Now, how will this happen? This happens only if in the childhood you had that tendency that was cultivated, this particular hour of reading and writing. Okay, so we need to ensure that they have the right kind of books at the right age, which they can read. We should ensure that they have, all kinds of elocution competitions, or because writing is not only writing, even speaking is like writing only. Correct? Because these are all hobbies actually, which will be very useful later. Raga, music. Aruda Mataji would say, and I very strongly feel for it, that every child should be taught classical music in childhood. The reason why I'm saying that is because it's not about, you know, everybody, every child may not sing like Bhimsen Joshi or Pandit Jasaraj or something. It's not about becoming a professional classical singer. But it is about, developing that interest in music. And music soothes one's mind and heart so much. You know, later in life, when there is stress due to so much of studies and stress in job, etc., if the child has an interest in music, he or she will be able to take a harmonium and just sit down and sing for half an hour. And that will completely relax the mind. Now, please understand, for that to happen in adulthood, in childhood, he or she should have learned some music. So I feel very strongly, and this music, if you see the Shastriya Sangeet, you know, any kind of Shastriya Sangeet you take in India, whether it is Hindustani, whether it is South Indian Carnatic or any other form, or even other arts like dance, whether it may be Bharatnatyam, whatever, all these are, Indian music and arts, every child should know something. Okay, some child may be good with mridanga, some child may be good with harmonium, violin, flute, whatever. And believe me, every child can do something. It's not that music is everyone's call, actually. Music is natural to every soul in this world. So I feel, why I'm talking this here is because this can be done only in childhood. So please remember, we are talking about things that can be done in childhood. Some things have to be done at the right time. You can't teach, a 40-year-old man can also start learning music, but it's actually going to be much more difficult. For a child, it's actually easier. Child has time and so on. So raga, similarly rote, by hearting shlokas. It's so good for the brain. And it is so relaxing also, if you see in some way. And it is also very a devotional way of expression. So maybe with Brahma Samhita, some verses of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, or if you have the ability, even much, much more than that. Maybe even in your own family tradition, like we come from Tamil family. So there are, for example, so many beautiful writings in Tamil. So similarly, in every language in India, I'm sure there will be wonderful works, poetry. Like in Maharashtra, there is Tukaram Abhanga, right? It's very beautiful, the Abhangas of Tukaram. So I have a friend here, Shwetadi Prabhu, very beautifully recites all those. And that's because in his childhood, he had studied that. That's why he's able to do that now. So this by hearting, rote, ratta marna, this should start from the age of six. You know, we should encourage them and they will love it. Children like to recite these things. You know, generally sadhana, children like a very colorful sadhana. I'm sure all of you may have noticed with small children, it's very difficult to make them sit and do japa. You know, because that is a little more difficult. You need to focus a little more. So maybe they can do it for a very short time. But if you give them a more colorful process of sadhana where they, you know, they buy heart things, they do deity worship, they do all these things, these actually can become hobbies for them. Again, deity worship is a very wonderful hobby because it engages all your senses. Similarly, hobbies I have put here, logical abilities, that is also hobby only. When I say arithmetic, it not only means mathematical, any kind of logical thinking stuff, you know, like even a game like chess, for example, kind of logical moves, strategic moves, etc., kind of considered good for boys and girls in general. Even all these physical things and non-competitive hobbies are even better, like Malkhamb. You know, I'm sure some of you know what is Malkhamb, so I put a picture over there. Trekking, going to trekking to various places, ensuring that boys are fit. So why I'm saying this is because all these are hobbies that can be cultivated in childhood only. And let us remember that in later ages, even all of us need something to relax, right? I mean, when we are also stressed out, humko kuch to chahiye relax karne ke liye. And if you have cultivated the right hobby when you were a child, it will be helpful to you in your adulthood. Otherwise, the simple hobby nowadays, everybody is on the screen only, always seeing movies on Netflix and all that. So that's the most dangerous hobby. You know, that's the like, right? Netflix, Hotstar, all these channels are there where everybody is having subscription and people are continuously watching movies and television series. So that becomes the default hobby if there is no other hobby in life. But if we teach them these things, and someone wrote on the chat that my child doesn't like to write. I would say that writing comes a little later. It comes at the age of 12, 13, etc. We should encourage them to write. And I think now, for each of these hobbies, you need the right teacher. I have myself seen there are some very good teachers who teach you how to write, how to express yourself. And our children should learn that because that's a very important part of your hobby and your growing up. Even reading, not just reading the school books, but reading books, historical books, reading books. I think actually parenting is a lot of hard work in one sense where, you know, according to the nature of your child, because one thing I would admit that every child is different. We're talking here more general principles, but ability to get the right kind of books actually, you know. So we should be careful what we are giving them. So a 13-year-old boy should not read a novel where there is romance in it, right? Because that's not appropriate for them. So we need to identify the right books and give it to them in that age. So I think that these things will go a long way. It's a very big investment in your child if you help your son and daughter to develop the right hobbies in childhood. They will really thank you, you know, when they have grown up, because they will feel a very fulfilled life and a life of much less stress, right? Yeah, the next point, practical topic, etiquette at home and dealing with family.
Okay, so there's a you can see a family photograph over here where we can see grandparents, uncle, aunt, and everybody. So what this photograph suggests that from childhood itself, our children should learn how to deal with the extended family, with relatives, grandparents, and other like uncles, aunts, mama, chacha, everybody. Sometimes as devotees, we feel that if some relatives are not devotees and they may have different kind of lifestyle, we try to stay away from them. Rather, what we could do is that we can see what are their strengths. Like say that relative may not be a very good devotee, but they may have some other strengths. Like maybe they are very good at science, or history, or some skill like that. And keeping that in as a common connection, we can connect with them with that. So our children can also connect with them with that aspect, which is good in them. Like I said, as I said, some relativists say very good with science. So our children can connect with them with that. Or somebody is very good with history, that relative knows the whole family tree history. So we can encourage our children that, you know, we are going for this wedding and this particular relative is coming. You're going to also meet him. And you can talk to him about our family tree. He's very good at that. He knows everything. You know, like family tree nowadays, and hardly people make family trees but it's very important to know. And children get very interested in that. Family tree means several generations behind, who they were, what they did, which village of India they hailed from. What kind of occupation they had, what kind of life they led. So it is very interesting when we go behind like that to our roots and find out what our ancestors were like. And there are some people, even in our relative circle, who keep track of all these things very nicely, till three generations behind. And not only the immediate family tree, like our father, father's father, father's father's father, but even little more extended branches. And that can become a very, very interesting topic. And just giving you an example that even if such a relative may not be a very good devotee, we may not connect with them as on devotional aspects, but there are different aspects, there's different strengths they may have, and we can connect with them in on that platform, and we can teach our children to connect with them like that. And be respectful to them. So in this way, if we find out some common things and connect, then children can learn to connect with anybody, all relatives. We don't have to discriminate that, okay, this is devotee, this is non-devotee, I will not speak to him. So we can connect with everybody. They understand what are the boundaries, what to talk to whom, what not to speak. Sometimes we have outside tutors. We have outside tutors for some specialized subjects. So these are professional tutors. Sometimes they may start talking about philosophy. But then our children start developing a sense of discrimination or critical thinking, where they understand that, okay, from this teacher, I have to learn this subject. I am not here to learn philosophy from this teacher. So now they understand and they don't get confused that, okay, this teacher is trying to say something off track, but that's not what I'm here to learn from him. So they know how to connect to people. That's one important thing. And also another thing is that when children are very small, it is good to be exemplary and be very nicely in front of them. Very good example, right example, all that. But as children grow up, when they approach teenage and grow up like that, they see and hear everything that's happening at home. And staying in flats, it is not possible that we hide everything from them. It is just not practical and possible like that. So many times from our telephone conversations, from when some people come home and we talk to them, even if we tell children, you all go inside, they understand many things and they also question what's happening. So when children grow up beyond teenage, it is, we have to discuss and we have to tell them some things. We cannot completely hide everything from them, especially when it comes to our own family. Of course, if we are playing roles of counselors and it's about some other devotees like that, then there's no need to share that. And such meetings can be outside the home. But with relatives and extended family members, sometimes it becomes unavoidable. So these things with teenage children, it becomes inevitable to discuss with them that, okay, what happened? These are the issues they are facing. And discuss with them that, okay, what went wrong? How we should not commit the same mistake. Then it is because of that mistake that they have been doing that they have landed into this kind of a trouble. So we give them that kind of a perspective, that learn from this like that. So that is one thing, that frank discussions with children. and even our own shortcomings. Like when they are very small, children sleep for a long time. So it is easy that when they are sleeping, parents can have their differences or shout at each other. But as children grow up, they are watching that sometimes parents are also becoming irritable. They are under stress. They are seeing everything very, very, very carefully. So at that time, it is important that we give them the understanding that as parents, we are also human beings. We also commit mistakes. We are not the supreme lord, that we are 100% exemplary. We show them the real picture and don't keep them under any kind of illusion. They see the reality of life and learn from that. And we can, after parents cool down, we can tell them that, yes, maybe I should have responded like this. Okay, I'm sorry, I was under stress, I shouted at you. Maybe next time I'll do better. So we discuss, we have a frank discussion with children. This is very important as children grow up, that we don't try to put up an artificially very, very exemplary behavior. And also on top, you see two pictures of, there's one, a very urban city, and there's a tribe. So this was a case study done by a researcher. He went to a tribal community called Matsigenka, and he saw that in this community, the families had many children, and he observed very closely how they all behaved. He saw that in this tribe, these children, there was no need to tell them anything. They had such a sense of responsibility and sense of duty and belonging towards their family and community, that without being told by their parents, these children would do many things. If something had to be bought from outside, or some cleaning has to be done, or say clothes have to be put on the clothes line, or whatever, some daily chores are there. So this researcher observed that these children are on their own doing the routine work, whatever has been assigned to the different members of the family. They are doing it on their own without being told several times, or without being told even once. And the same person came to the urban city. He came to Los Angeles, and he saw that the children over there, even after being told several times, they would not get up and do what they are supposed to do. Even their own personal things, like even if the urban city child has to take his bath, it's time to go for bath. He's not ready to go for bath. His parents are pushing him, go take a bath, go take a bath. But the child is not moving from his sofa. So even for his own personal things, he's not moving. What to talk about doing, sharing other responsibilities at home and of the family. So this was a major difference that he observed between this, the city child and the rural child. So what we learn from this is that children from their childhood, it would have a sense of responsibility, a sense of duty at home, that they are part of the family. That means that they are not here to live like prince or a princess. They also have some rules to play. Yes, parents are there to take care and do everything for them, but they also have some share of responsibility at home. Like say simple things, like parents have gone out, they are getting late. Okay, so it's time to do some evening puja, and then children should know that, okay, this time up when parents are at home, they always do this small ritual at home in front of the altar. Say lighting a lamp or whatever. So the child should do it at that particular time, even if parents are not there. Or, say it's time to boil the milk at home, mother is not at home, so the child takes care of that. Small things, every family knows what has to be done at what particular time. So children also should be aware of that and be very dutiful and behave accordingly, you know. So that is very important to teach the child from their childhood.
Yeah. Now we are going to the last part. There are just some quotes. We'll end with that. So some quotes with given by Chanakya. So we all know that Chanakya was a very intelligent person, and he had to say many wonderful things about life in general. So he has several quotes about parenting, related to success of family life, related to the importance of being learned. Chanakya gives a lot of importance about ensuring that the son is learned and not a fool. And there are some very two important verses of Chanakya. Let's look at all of them quickly. So I've just put the translations here. So look at that. Chanakya related verses related to success of family life. So look at what he says. He says that just as an entire forest becomes fragrant by the presence of a single flowering tree, so a bright sun glorifies an entire family life. So this is to keep us all motivated that if we train our children nicely, they can actually glorify the entire family line. Okay, so this is actually a verse from Garuda Puran with Chanakya quotes. And on the other hand, look at what Chanakya says. As a single withered tree, he set a place, burns the entire forest, so a bad son can destroy the entire family. Just like Duryodhan, right? Bad son destroyed the entire family. Look at the next one, positive one. Just as night is brightened by the moon, so the son who is knowledgeable devotee of the Lord illuminates the entire family. Right? So he's comparing the sun to a moon. Look at the next one. Of what use are many sons who only cause grief and vexation? A single son adorned with the qualities of a pure devotee is the support and shelter of his entire family. Look at that. And the last one is a very famous one. Ekas chandra tamohanti nachatara sahasrashah. Chanakya says a single son endowed with good qualities is far better than hundreds of sons devoid of them. There is only one moon in the sky, but it dispels the darkness. But even though there are so many stars, it doesn't. So this is all to motivate us to ensure that we have children in our family, because, you know, this whole Vamsha concept is a very important concept. If you see Bhagavatam, how many chapters are there talking only about Vamsha, right? This fellow's son was this, this fellow's son was this, his son was this, his son was this. You can see in Bhagavatam, those of you who have read several chapters, you will see there are chapters and chapters on Vamsha only. Because Vamsha is very important. So let's not minimize the importance of that, you know, thinking that these are materialistic and all. No, it's not like that. That is what you leave back in the world. When we are dead and gone, all you have left in the world is the kind of children that you have produced who will continue the legacy of serving the world in a particular way. Correct? So that's how it is. So whichever family we come from. So it is very important aspect of success of family life, the way we raise our children. So this is to motivate us to give importance to it, to give time to it. And generally, anything you give importance and priority, it gets done. I think it ultimately boils down to that. There's another verse of Chanakya, very important. He says that if the husband and wife live together peacefully, then Lakshmi resides in the house of that person. I think this is also important to talk of in the context of raising children, because the most important thing in raising children is the example the husband and wife give at home. Correct. If you give the right example, and even if the husband and wife can live together without fighting, I mean, there may be some small differences of opinion, but no major kalaha, and, you know, not that there is a major fight going on. Just in a nice loving relationship, if it is there, that itself is a great amount of security to the child. Right. So I think it's all about prioritizing, putting the right things. Now look at the other quotes of Chanakya on being learned, because Chanakya gives a lot of focus on this point to ensure that your son is learned. Look at what he says. Give your virgin daughter in marriage to a good family and see that your son becomes learned. Okay, so learned means vidwan in Shastra, etc. So he gives a lot of importance to that. Look at the next one that he says. Residence in a village of low-class people, service to the low-born, unwholesome food, a frowning wife, a fool as a son, and a widowed daughter, these six burn without fire. So he says there are six things that burn without fire. And one of them is a son who is a fool. There is another verse also, right? You know that Rupavati Bharya Shatru Putra Shatru Apanditah, he says. Right? Chanakya says that if you have the wife is too beautiful, she may be an enemy. And if the son is a fool, he's an enemy. Okay, so it's important to ensure that we don't have foolish children, right? So that begins from Garbhadhan. It begins before Garbhadhan. It actually begins with conceiving in the mind the kind of child you need. If you see in the Bhagavatam also, it comes, right? Krishna and Vasudeva and Devaki, Krishna appears in their mind first and then in the womb. So that is Garbhadhan Sanskar. You first meditate on what kind of child you want. And that meditation should be realistic meditation. It should be in line with the kind of family qualities that are present in our home. Not that I'm sitting here and thinking my child should play football like Maradona. How will that happen? Because there was no Maradona in my family only. Perhaps in my family, there was some very good characteristic which my father had, my grandfather had. I should meditate on that because that's how ultimately my child will come, right? So in this way, if you see our Shastra, they talk about Garbhadhan and everything so elaborately that raising children is a project that starts before the child is born, right? Look at the next one. What good is a cow that gives neither milk nor conceives? What is the use of a son who neither becomes a learned scholar nor a bhakta? Because Chanakya says it's useless. I mean, you have a son who is not even a scholar. Scholar means scholar of Shastra and not a devotee. Kuch kaam ka nahi hai aisa ladka. Look at the next one. He who is scorched in the miseries of material life attains peaceful shelter in the company of these three. Three things are important, he says, for someone who is suffering in this world. Dharmic children, chaste wife and devotees of the Lord. Association of devotees of the Lord. Ye teen hai toh aapka jeevan safal ho gaya. This is how Chanakya describes it. Look at these two verses of Chanakya. These are very important. Radharani Mataji has already quoted it, so I'll not talk too much about it. Lalayet pancha varshani dasha varshani taadayet praptute shodashe varsham putram mitra vadachare. Right? So the time between 6 to 15, this is the time when everything can be done. After 16, he's your friend. You can't do much. Now a friendly relationship. Now you can only set an example. Radharani Mataji says that point very nicely. She says that after, now you can only set an example. You can tell the child, you can instruct the child, you must do this. No, sab chala gaya, uska time chala gaya abhi. And the other verse also is a very important verse of Chanakya. Lalayet bahavo dosho, taadayet bahavo gunaha, tasmat putramcha shishyamcha, taadayet nanu lalayet. He says that just by pampering, bad qualities develop. And we should not pamper children too much. Taadayet bahavo gunaha. If you are strict with them, strict doesn't mean beating. You don't have to beat them. But you have to be strict with discipline. Bahavo gunaha. Good qualities come. And therefore, Chanakya says, with your sons and your disciples, taadayet. Be strict. Nanu lalayet. Don't pamper them. In fact, in our Krishna Leela, Krishna killing this Vatsasur demon, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has written, every demon Krishna kills is compared to one anartha. And Vatsasur represents the anartha of spoiled children. Okay, so it's like when children are spoiled due to pampering and due to bad parenting, due to bad example at home, they become like Vatsasur. And they become actually a disturbance in society. And there are too many disturbances in society already. So at least we need not add to that, right? So let's end. So I'll just conclude what we discussed in the last 1 hour, 10 minutes, and then maybe see if there are some questions or comments. So we started with this concept of five koshas, remember? So this was just a recap because this was already spoken in an earlier seminar. So Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnanamaya, Anandamaya kosha, five koshas. And then goal of parenting. Remember, there were four goals. Dharmavan, Balavan, Kushalta, and finally Vidwan. It's in that order. Dharmavan is most important, right? And then this Balavan, and then Kushalta, and then finally it was Vidwan, right? And then we spoke about two themes from Bhagavad Gita, very important theme. This was the centerpiece of our discussion. We said that growing up children is basically cultivating that pot, and that pot is Dharma Kshetra. Dharma Kshetra, so Dharma, I spoke in the context of Kula Dharma Jati Dharma. How to celebrate festivals, rituals at home in connection with our family traditions. And we need to do some research on it also sometimes. We may have lost touch with it, I mean, but it is very important. And one should not think that, oh, my family is useless family. One should never think like that. Unfortunately, some of us have thought like that or some of us think like that. So we should actually connect to our elders in our family and learn good things in our own family and community, right? So if you remember, we spoke on this Jati Dharma and Kula Dharma. Then I spoke about Kshetra. We spoke about how Kshetra means the character, the capacity, the limitation of an individual. And how, for example, the monkeys, each monkey in Ramayana knew how much he can jump. So similarly, the child should know the character and capacity and limitation of himself. And this should be part of the learning experience in childhood. And we should be with our children in this learning process. And then we spoke of four practical points to remember while raising boys. The first one was media. I spoke about the importance of brahmacharya. We spoke about what should be seen, what should not be seen. Right. And this is all before 15-16, mind you. Then we spoke briefly on sibling rivalry, dealing with teenage boys. Then we spoke about hobbies, the importance of having dharmic hobbies. I spoke about the importance of reading, writing, speaking, music, right? Playing traditional games. So all these are very good hobbies. Trekking, so many. You can just think about it. List is unlimited. And I told that if we don't develop the right hobby in childhood, the only hobby the fellow knows later is to watch Netflix and Amazon. That's all they will do later in life, right? So the importance of cultivating right hobbies in childhood. And then finally, we spoke in the practical session about the importance of home, how to deal with family members, how to understand everybody has their plus and minus. So how to deal with every person in our extended family appropriately. That's another thing we spoke in the practical section. And finally, we ended with quotes from Chanakya on how our family is considered a success and the importance of being learned. Okay, so that's where we are. Thank you very much for the patient hearing, everyone. In case there are any questions or comments, we can have a look at that briefly. I don't know if we have time still, but maybe 5-10 minutes.
Yeah, Broji. So there are a few questions that have been shared with us personally also. So I'll just pass them on. You can hear me, right, Prabhu?
Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah. So there was some on the chat, but because we were speaking, we weren't able to see the chat.
So I'll,
because we had opened this presentation.
Right. So I'll look at the chat as well and the ones which have been asked personally and I'll just share. Right. So thank you, Broji. It was a really great class. One question that we got is, so in the context of teenage children, especially Mataji was saying that rather than instructing, we should say that we should talk about the ill effects and the good things about certain decisions, right? So one question was, how could you please elaborate how to explain ill effects of playing video games or watching cartoons in a way that children can understand?
As far as this video games is concerned, it's something that they should never get into. This, especially I see today, this PUBG game and PUBG or PUBG, whatever they call it, these kind of games which are there, so my point is, it should not come to that position where the child desperately wants to play and we are holding him back. So basically, even before that, especially when children are small, their schedule is in our hands by and large, correct? Small children, they don't have so much independence on their scheduling of life. Their whole schedule is decided by and large by parents only. So we should keep them busy in a very positive way. Positive way means, I'm not saying not only studying academics, that is very important, but besides academic study, enough playing. They should at least, children from that age 6, now at least 2-3 hours, they should play. They should run around, they should play, and they should be tired actually. They shouldn't be time for these things. See, that's, especially when they're very small, their time management, as I told you, is with us. So it shouldn't come to that point. But still, when they will ask the question, when they go to play, they will see that other friends are playing PUBG. So they will come and ask, can I also play? So we need to tell them at that time about, what are the disadvantages of these. We should tell them that you better play, some game face to face with someone. Maybe you play chess, you play carrom, you play, snake and ladder, if you want to play indoor games, or you play badminton, you play Malkhamb, wrestling, swimming. So many outdoor games are also there. We should encourage our children. And we should tell them that, see, this is much better than this. So my understanding is that we should give the child a positive alternative for everything. So the child, it should never come to a situation where the child is saying that I have nothing to do and the only thing I know now is to play PUBG. So it should not come to that. So I think, schedule management of children, especially below 12, please remember their schedule is in your hand completely. When they get up, when they sleep, what they do exactly at what time, everything is in parents' control only. So till that time, you put the right schedule, then automatically from the age of 13, you don't have control on schedule. But once you have put the right type of samskar in the child, then the child will not ask that only, because now the child has so many nice hobbies to do. Right, so a child has something wonderful to do. Why will you want to play PUBG? So that would not be so attractive. So I think it's more about prevention itself rather than coming to the situation where they want it. Yeah.
Right. Thank you, bro. Okay. Another question is that as devotees, especially, there are times when parents are busy and occupied with some spiritual practice or some service, right? So at this time, how to keep boys engaged? Because we have seen that many times this is the time when children become distracted and tend towards doing some of these activities, right? Like playing games, watching cartoons, like that.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, this is one of the, I remember attending some programs also in our congregation several times before, where, you know, all the parents would be attending Bhagavad Gita class and all the children are sitting inside and watching TV, or, you know, they have opened some video and they're having a good time. So this is actually, you know, from raising child perspective, this is very dangerous, because it's like, you know, on one hand, the parents are doing some very nice spiritual activity and all the children are sitting and watching something that they shouldn't even watch. Okay, maybe they're watching IPL, you know, which is again a best example of something which is pure waste of time. So I really think that in any satsang programs or anything like these, there should be someone with the parents, with the children also, to ensure that it doesn't happen. I think my wife wants to add.
Sometimes it is good if one parent stays back and they take turns to attend some programs like that. And when children are very small, so they can attend programs turn by turn and give quality time to their children.
I've also heard and seen many examples of, you know, one child. First of all, it's possible everyone should have at least two children, because that company is very important. Sibling company is very important. I mean, all of us who have a brother and sister in life, we know that we gained so much from them. Having one child is an increasing trend in today's world. That leads to one kind of loneliness. And another thing that I've noticed with many devotees is that they go for program and their child is sitting at home alone. And, you know, then home alone with laptop and everything, computer, television, is very dangerous. So, yeah, so those things should be in order, actually. So as I said, till the age of 12 or 13, our children's schedule should be very well planned by us. Ideal mind is a devil's workshop. And a boy or a girl from the age of 8, 9 who has time but nothing to do, very dangerous. They should have things to do, and it is possible to do that. So actually, parenting is in one sense a full-time activity. I'm at least happy due to the lockdown, parents are able to spend more time with their children because we are not running around anywhere. Everybody's stuck in their home only. So in one sense, that is good.
Thank you, bro. We have a few related questions around the personality of the child, right? If there are some children who cannot concentrate or who are not attracted to some of the hobbies that we discussed, right? Like reading and music, etc. Then how do we still engage them?
So they may be interested in playing then, right? They may be interested in playing games, swimming, trekking. See, I agree. Everybody may not be a scholarly type person who will read and write and express thoughts. So that may be fine, but at least some aspect should be done. But besides that, there are other things. Then physically they can do that. Or, you know, children can do many things with hand. I remember attending a session with Makanlal Prabhu, who was a very good teacher. So he would talk about, you know, the importance of teaching skills like crochet and knitting for children. Because, right, clay modeling, with clay playing, doing things with clay. So there are many things. So see, again, it's correct what the question is, right, that every child cannot do some kind of activity. So we are talking broad here, right? Cooking. You know, boys and girls from the age of 8, they should be in the kitchen. They should be able to do things. And everybody likes to do things with their hands and legs, right? Maintaining a garden, if possible, if you have a facility of a small garden at home, you know, maintaining garden, taking care of all the plants. So there are so many things you can think of. So like that. I mean, it should never happen that screen is the only option. Then remember what I said. Then it will ultimately come to Netflix and Amazon. That's it. Amazon Prime and Netflix Hotstar. That's where Sony Entertainment, whatever, you know, all these channels that are there, you know, online, all this stuff. So that's where it will come and stop. Then that is the only thing I can do. And it should never come to that. Before that, some other thing should have been done. And I think it's possible for every child to be engaged.
Right. Thank you, bro. Another kind of related question related to hobbies, that some hobbies, in fact, quite a few hobbies require putting children in classes, right? And so that they should learn from some teacher. So, which can become expensive depending on the income of the parents. So also there are other challenges like sending them to classes and arranging for their transport and things like that. So for an, you know, some average middle class kind of family who are whatever struggling with work and also whatever income they have, how is it like able, how should we manage so that our child is properly engaged also and, you know, within the...
I agree. One thing that has happened, you know, because of this lockdown, which I liked because of the lockdown, many things happened, good things because of the lockdown. So many wonderful activities have started online. And it is screen, but still it has started. So if someone cannot travel, best is to learn music from someone live. But if, yeah, if somebody doesn't have money and the resources to do that, then we can look at some other thing that can be done at home itself. So then that's fine. So the world doesn't end anywhere. So if it's not possible to do something, then what can be done? That's okay. But then one can look at something which is perhaps not too expensive, right? So like the other things that I spoke of, whether it is crochet, knitting or cooking and, you know, so many simple things around our home, maybe maintaining a garden in our society or even playing games is also fine to tell you. I mean, let the child play 2 hours cricket, no problem. But he need not watch IPL on screen. Right? He can play cricket because that is at least good for his body. Correct? He'll be playing, he'll be running around, he'll be tired by the time he comes home. Because boys need that. Boys need physical exercise. Yoga. Yoga is cheap. You can do yoga at home. Yoga and pranayama. And we really think that every boy from the age of 10, 11 should be taught. And boys' bodies are so flexible. By the age of 13, 14, they can easily do most of the asanas, which we adults cannot do. Correct? You want to do Sarvangasana and Viparita Karani and Shirshasana. So many asanas. Boys at the age of 13, 14, their bodies are flexible. They can do everything. And that is cheap also. It's free. You can do yoga at home. So we have to think according to our situation. And I think the answers will be there. Yeah.
Thank you, bro. Another question was what to do if sometimes there are challenges between the parents also. If one parent is, like you were talking about screen time, right? So if one parent is very addicted to the screen and don't have the same kind of goal that the child should not be, you know, so attached to watching things, etc., then how to manage in such a situation?
You mean one parent is
always watching screen
and the other parent is okay. So see, sometimes it may be that the father is more on screen, maybe his work demands that, his occupation demands that. But if he's playing games or doing something else on the screen, then that is not good. Then they should work on it. But if father is on the screen because that is his occupational demand and is doing his office work, then the child should be explained that, you know, father is doing his office work and it's needed for him, but that's not needed for you at this age of your life. So mother can maybe come in between and balance it out in that way. So, of course, nowadays, ever since school is also online, so children are forced to use mobile and laptop for this entire year school was online. So they have used a lot of devices and attended school that way. But that was a kind of an apadharma. It was not a normal situation. That's why they had to go digital. But if it is focused on education, and to learn something constructive, it is okay. But even in that, one of the parents should monitor what the child is doing. Many times, it looks like the child is, and these children, you know, the younger they are in age, the better they are in technology. They know more features of a mobile than their parents know. So parents may think that, okay, my child is attending class, and she may put him on the mobile and is wearing his earphones and busy, and mother has gone to do her work or whatever. But
the child should be monitored. It is possible that the child is having personal chat with another friend or doing many such kind of other activities which are quite deviated from the goal for which he has been assigned. So that also needs monitoring. Even if a child is attending some classes online, it needs monitoring, because they start personal chats and so many things they start doing nowadays, and they are very, very good at it. So they need to be monitored. And of course, if one parent is saying that screen is not good for you, that is always good for the child. But it has to be discussed why the other parent is encouraging the screen, either is using the screen a lot. So if it is for his office purpose, then it should be fine. But otherwise, they should kind of reduce it, or for the betterment of the child, set a good example.
Yeah, also one more point which I want to add here is that especially for boys less than 16, boys and girls, they should not have their individual smartphone. As in, all the smart devices at home should be accessible by all family members. There should be nothing personal. That means a boy or a girl at the age of 15 cannot have his or her own personal, you know, mobile phone, smartphone, where he or she is having chat with anybody and all that. No, that culture should not be encouraged at home. It should be like a family. There can be one or two phones at home which everybody can use and everybody can see. So that privacy is not good at that age. Maybe after the age of 18, it is okay. But till 12th standard, it is better that all the smart devices are public at home. So that, you know, there is no way of going wrong. Otherwise, you know, on this Instagram and this and that. And we should ban certain things, like I'm giving an example of Instagram or Facebook, etc. They're not to be used at all. So I think that is also very important. So that culture should be there at home with children. Yeah.
Thank you, Prabhuji. One question about jati dharma and kula dharma, right? So some family traditions, like this Prabhuji is asking, that their family was an agricultural family. So many of their festivals traditionally, they revolve around agriculture, right? But even from 2-3 generations ago now, they are not really connected to agriculture at all. Now they have come to city and living in the city. So it's difficult, basically. So how to maintain family traditions in such situations, right? Where you've come quite far from your family situation.
I feel that on certain occasions and such events, they can go to their village and participate. So that will be a very nice experience. Like we have seen, we have devotees over here who have their farms in their village. So they are in the city because they have to make they are working over here in some company or whatever. But very frequently, weekends, whenever there are holidays, they immediately rush to their village. They know all their their village occupations. Like they know if they are from farming background, so they know everything, how to harvest, how to sow seeds, which season, what to do, how to take the seeds to the mill, polishing. They know everything. They know how to deal with bulls, cows, what to do when. So though they are working in a city, they know everything about their village. So they have kept very good connection with those roots, and they are very, very balanced in that. So devotees who have such background already, that's very, very good, and they should keep that connection, and they should whenever possible go to your village and get connected with those kind of festivals and events.
And even those who don't have that connection, you know, who are pure urban fellows, you know, like my family, honestly, we don't have much farm or anything, but having friends who are like that and connecting with their families, going to their places with our children, you know, connection with Goshala, taking children to Goshala, allowing them to serve cows. These are extremely important part of growing up. Very, very important. There can't be a compromise on that.
Thank you, Prabhuji Mathi. One question about the current situation, that because school is online and everything is online, and there was a lockdown and things like that also, right? So the children couldn't meet many other children and go outside to play, right? So then they were getting attached to watching things on computer or playing games on the computer. and difficult to engage them. So how to manage?
Yeah, actually, that was one flip side of this lockdown. Unnecessarily, people have got attached. I think the first thing one must do is ensure that, especially if the children are small, you know, below 13, 14, they should remove them out of that. To remove them out of that, do that with something positive children can do. I think there are so many things. There is Krishna consciousness, storytelling, discussion of our Ramayana, Mahabharata, whatever. You know, deity worship, you know, now, of course, now lockdown is not so strict also. So children can go out and play and all also. Right. So I think that time is over now. That strict lockdown is already behind us. I don't think that will again happen. Now the lockdown is more strategic. It's not the same thing that was there last March, April, May. But in principle, let's keep this bottom line very clear. I mean, that's the worst thing to do, because then what happens, that spoils all culture, everything. You know, then it starts with, right? So it leads to, I think as parents, we should be aware of the dangers of that. If we take it very casually, then well, we understand the repercussions of that.
Right. Thank you, bro.
I think we should end now because it's past time, whatever schedule we had. It was supposed to be 5:30. Right. Thank you, Vrindavan Krishna Prabhu. Nice computer.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thank you.
Just very a few questions if we could take, Prabhuji, 2-3 like important ones.
Okay, sure. We can.
Right. So one question about your personal experience, Prabhuji. Like since you all have homeschooled your children, could you just tell us a little bit about how your experience has been homeschooling and, you know, in the Indian context and
Well, we enjoyed our homeschooling journey. I don't know whether my children enjoyed so much. They're sitting right in front of me and they're smiling as well. But as parents, we enjoyed because it allowed us to be with them for 10 years. Now my elder one is 16, younger one is 13. So they are at home since the age of 6, basically, first standard. So I wouldn't even want to say that everybody must try it out. Somehow it worked for us. One thing is I am a professor in a college, so I have to go to office at almost 10:30 in the morning, which is quite late, and I come back by 6:30. So my timings were very regulated. So I had a lot of time. I myself would spend 2 hours daily teaching the children. So I had that kind of time. We would have a morning program also for a long part of their childhood. Reading Mahabharata, doing Mangalarti and so many things, reciting Gita Shlokas. And I would teach mathematics and history and then only go to college. So I had a lot of time. So that's why it worked for me. And my wife is at home. So she, you know, by 10:30, she would wrap up all her work and then whole day she had with the children. Right. For some things, we employed tutors, not so much academic subjects, that by and large we did it. We felt that it allowed us to help them identify which subjects they want to study, etc. But I think there's a whole different topic, homeschooling. So, I mean, it can be an entire seminar in itself. So I don't want to go too much into it. But in short, we enjoyed it. But again, I would never say that it is for everyone and so on. It depends on the family situation. I still always believe that a very good school which gives balanced, all-round, developed education is the best. Though maybe in our context, we didn't find a school like that. That's why we did what we did. But I think in the larger context of families, the best thing for children is to go outside. And so that's also quite a good option. Yeah, okay.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Maybe we can then have one session on homeschooling sometime in future, right? Anyway, one last question maybe. That about Krishna consciousness, if we enforce spiritual activities on our children, which they may not be very interested in always, considering the association that they have in the world and etc., right, when they go to school and everything, then do we have a risk that we may end up pushing them away from Krishna consciousness, and you know, how to balance that they should not feel like it is being forced on them or something like that?
I think there's no question of forcing Krishna consciousness. I think that from childhood, there are some activities of Krishna consciousness which are very jolly. Simple examples, let us take deity worship. Every child loves kirtan. There is no child in ISKCON who did not like kirtan. You know, they would like it. They may not like japa, but kirtan they would like. Going to holy places. Every child likes, you know, it's a nice picnic or whatever you want to call. Going to Vrindavan, Mayapur, Jagannath Puri, different holy places, different temples. Right? So that is also something they like. Hearing stories from Rama and Mahabharata as they grow, according to their age. Reading books. You know, good books there, like A Journey Home is there. It's a very good book for boys to read as they grow up. So like that, there are so many we can collect. So reading good stories, hearing good classes according to their age. We can't give philosophy classes below 15 years. But talking about stories and lessons from that, all this is very joyful. Rarely have I come across a child who would say that I don't want to do this. Perhaps the only place where there could be some reluctance is japa. You know, because that is perhaps a little monotonous, a child may feel, you know, saying the same maha mantra repeatedly. So that shouldn't be forced too much. Maybe they may do 5-10 minutes in the beginning, whatever they can, according to their liking. But I think other than that, all other aspects of Krishna consciousness, every child likes. Correct. So there shouldn't be this thing in that. So the trouble comes is due to bad association or something when they lose interest or things like that. So I feel, especially for boys, there should be always some connection with Shastra, discussion. You know, that Vijnanamaya Kosha is there now from the age of 14, 15. Discussion from Bhagavad Gita, discussion from Shastra. It should be at home. There should be some environment of discussion where we are, as family, we sit together and discuss scripture. That would help in, you know, giving them that intellectual conviction and you know, Shastra conviction to go ahead. And then the taste is there only of all the wonderful spiritual activities.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
We went over time also. But thank you for a really, very practical, very focused class. Normally we end by summarizing some points of the class, but that also you did so nicely at the end of the class. So I would just like to say that each of the points that we talked about was very practical, something that I'm sure every parent faces while raising their children. And thank you so much, Prabhu. Thank you for taking out time. Thank you for extending.
Thanks.
For everyone, please connect with Practical Spirituality. We have links in chat for all the platforms where we are present to stay in touch so that we can reach out about future classes that we will arrange like these. Thank you for attending today. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.